William Morrow and Harper Audio present Activation Degradation, a novel by Marina J. Lostetter, performed by Hayden Bishop. Part 1. Robot. Coming online. Designation: Autonomous Maintenance System, Unit 4. Activation Instance. Emergency. Age of flexible biomechanical materials, 6 minutes 14 seconds. Lifetime radiation exposure, total ionizing dose, 0.0002%. Database upload, 97% complete. Please wait. Please wait. Chapter 1. The first 40 seconds following AMS Unit 4's activation were nothing but chaos and pain. Its biohardware had been fused to its chassis in a flurry of accelerated growth. The flexible pistons that drove the hinges of its joints were raw with the surge of new lubricants, feeds, and wires. Internal warnings flickered through its central processing unit. Available memory was low. Perhaps something hadn't been installed properly. The entire integrated platform system, of which the unit was a small part, was running at 30 yottaflops per second, far below the expected speed, and the unit's parts were stiff, as though they hadn't quite finished cooling and solidifying. Perhaps the test flex had been skipped. This was not the usual initialization process. As it rose half out of the reconstitution pod, it opened its intake vents wide and threw back the shutters from its cameras. The sounds filtering through its microphones were disorienting at first. A blaring siren came from everywhere, the rhythmic yawing ill-timed with the flashing of the emergency lights. The approximate temperature and pressure gauges in the unit's grasping pads told it cold and hard as it clung to the edges of the pod. Another unit detected its presence and hurried over to aid its emergence from the reconstitution station. "The transmission dishes are under attack," came an alert from inside Unit 4's CPU. It immediately identified the voice as that of its handler, stationed on Earth, which could interface with the robots via its buoy-routed, long-distance Ansible link. The FTL comms channel allowed for real-time instruction and direction, indispensable in an emergency. The unit accessed its primer containing the location, structure, and purpose of the mining platform. Flipping through the files, integrating them as quickly as possible, it did its best to orient itself, to find its marker on the map. And all the while, a red and yellow warning, warning, warning flashed across the uneven bulkheads, a flickering projection, stunning and distracting. It stumbled to the floor once out of the pod, the other unit, Unit 2, failing to keep it upright, clearly expecting the new robot to be able to maintain its own balance. The AMS units each had four limbs, which could contort into multiple shapes and positions, letting the soft robots become quadrupedal or bipedal at will. As Unit 4 struggled to stand erect, its bipedal option feeling more like a hindrance than a help in the moment, it found itself before a window, gazing out off the mining platform into the swirling, banded storms of the solar system's largest and most treacherous planet, Jupiter. The mining platform was a small, spinning sanctuary, a mere 700 million kilometers away from the gas giant's thermosphere. It currently rested between Io's plasma torus and Europa's neutral torus, utilizing the off-cast ions from the former to power itself. This was the robot's home. This was its whole world, and it was under attack. "Is it?" Unit 4 tried, but the drivers for its speakers hadn't been fully installed yet.
"The invaders, again, yes," said its handler.
"I'm sorry we have to welcome you into the world this way, Unit 4,
But if you and two don't get in those maintenance boats right now and incapacitate those bastards, the whole operation might go down. Acknowledged. Its core programming initiated. Protect and maintain the platform. The platform. The platform. It was still trying to assimilate all of this newness, to decipher just where it was and what it was and why it was. Let's start with where, it thought. This was the reconstitution and activation wing. Small. The room was only 6 meters by 6 meters, containing 3 pods for growing biomechanical robots, a manual input station, 3 doors, and a single window. The left door led to the fuel input center, the right to the waste depository. Just beyond the center door lay Arm E, a long hallway that connected to a spinning central hub. The spinning of the platform created simulated gravity of approximately 0.9 Gs. Primary equipment and monitoring stations formed bulky rooms at the end of each arm, 7 of them in all. 7 stations, 4 active AMS units, 1 invading ship. Finding its footing, AMS Unit 4 took unsure steps away from the window and toward the other pods. 1 was empty. 1 was active, but in the early growing stages. The top was hermetically sealed and UV shielded to protect the engineered biotech inside. Most of a unit's internal parts could not be directly exposed to radiation or atmosphere without immediate damage. They were delicate, but pliable. Plastic. And that plasticity was both their greatest weakness and greatest strength. My greatest weakness and my greatest strength, Unit 4 thought. A small, thin slit of a window allowed for visual monitoring of the robot's soft body development within. The new unit's chassis lay bare, a few cells coalescing and clinging, but this robot wouldn't be ready for activation for at least another 7 hours. To the boats, its handler said again with urgency. I'm sorry, Unit 4, quickly! Unit 4 felt the urgency, and yet its mind and body were still sluggish, still catching up. The chemicals didn't feel like they were pumping correctly through its tubing. Excessive vibrations tingled through its outer layers. We have to go, agreed Unit 2.
Remote fire is only doing so much, their handler said. Damn, ship keeps using the dishes as a shield. And there's no way I'm letting you move the platform itself any closer.
Something feels defective, AMS Unit 4 said. I'm concerned my activation process was faulty. My compounds, even my fluid pump they're...
It's adrenaline, its handler said. I shot you up. Your biological components need it right now, a lot of it. You're going to crash after, but we'll take care of that, all right? I just need you to do what I activated you to do, okay? I know this feels strange. I know it conflicts with your past memories of activation. I'm sorry. I know.
Apologies weren't needed. AMS Unit 4 was the one having a difficult time booting. It was already failing at the job it had been grown for. The panic and disappointment in its handler's voice was distressing. It wanted to be efficient, to do well, to execute its tasks swiftly and competently. I will show you the way, said Unit 2, placing one of its grasping pads on one of Unit 4's articulated arms. I was activated 2 days ago, it said as it reversed, keeping its focus on Unit 4. My process was much slower than yours, but I, too, was disoriented.
AMS Unit 4 looked into Unit 2's cameras, feeling both familiar with its sister unit and disconnected. The robots were all identical, based on the same schematics and consistently regrown from exactly the same vat of materials. It had memories of Unit 2 from before, but those were no more this exact same Unit 2 as it was the Unit 4 of times gone by. Each activation was different.
each reconstitution and regrowth different. Unit 4 returned to its files as the heavy airlock doors to the reconstitution room slid aside for the robots. Each arm on the rotating platform was an independent unit, with fireblocks and docking sockets in case of dislodging, replacement, or emergency detachment, an especially useful design element if Unit 4 failed in its task. It was still unsure of itself. Trying to pilot a boat in its state didn't feel efficient. It looked up everything it had on the craft, its steering, weapons system, navigation. "There are superfluous files in my databanks," it said, wandering through a maze of recall commands.
"I know, I didn't have time to cherry-pick for your particular expected functionalities," said its handler. "I just dumped everything in."
"Should I delete the unessential?"
It scanned the file categories, which included multiple languages, fuel processing and development, and
dance?
"It doesn't matter now. Just get to the damned boat. Please, Unit 4, I'm begging you."
It let the dispensable files remain. Unit 2 let it down the long arm, and the simulated gravity gradually shifted. Through another window, Unit 4 saw it, the nearest phased microwave array, little more than a sharp glint of silver to its cameras. Currently, the array lay no more than 250 kilometers off the platform, which meant if a dish were to dislodge at the correct angle, it could barrel into them. The debris would arrive in mere minutes, not enough time to safely reposition the station, resulting in various possible levels of damage. And if one of the helium-3 fusion reactors was hit, the reactor sat well within the haze layer of Jupiter's atmosphere, just above the troposphere. A safe distance from the maintenance platform under 99.8% of malfunction scenarios. However, if there was an explosion, the shockwave could easily reach them. Even as movable as the platform was, being tossed out of orbit could cause significant problems. If they fell too far into Jupiter's gravity well, there would be no escape, as their engines couldn't compensate. They could be torn apart by the storms, crushed by the atmospheric pressures, or hit dead on with a burst of radiation. 101 possible situations could permanently decommission all of the equipment and the entire operation, including every robot aboard. It couldn't let that happen. Wouldn't let it happen. Unit 4 brought up its Earth primer and saw a small blue-green world, well-tempered compared to the planet below. Earth relied on this mine for a third of its energy, and 98% of all Earth energy needs were met by off-world endeavors. That's what kept the planet safe and beautiful and well-balanced. Number of species, 5.2 million. Number of people, 1.8 billion. Those life forms were counting on it to stop the invaders, to save Earth from a crisis, from power outages and shortages that would inevitably lead to chaos and death. Through the window that ran the length of the platform arm, Unit 4 searched the assaulted array for signs of the invading craft, for a distant glint of sunlight off a hull, a flash from an energy weapon. Though it tried, focusing in as sharply as it could, it was unable to make out the alien ship. The majority of the platform was kept at 22.22 degrees Celsius, which felt stifling on Unit 4's new casing. The climate was supposed to be optimized. 22.22 degrees was the prime stimulating temperature for the robot's organic muscles, essential for peak performance. And yet, its casing was doing, shedding excess heat via water evaporation. Perhaps that was just further proof that Unit 4 was operating at less than optimal levels. But its handler wanted it moving, so it continued forward as quickly as it could. As the two units reached the center hub, they began to float. Here, the simulated gravity gave way to true microgravity. Unit 4 grabbed a helpful bar, and Unit 2 swiveled to look back at it.
"Systems level?"
it asked.
"Not at this time," Unit 4 admitted. "Perhaps one of the other units would be better qualified to pilot a boat."
"None of the others have undergone muscle memory stimulation. They could download the piloting program, but would have dissatisfactory reaction times. I believe I will have dissatisfactory reaction times. Our functionality is not for us to question, Unit 2 said.
True. Dish 7 has shattered, their handler yelled. Debris incoming. Get to the hangar.
2 minutes to impact, came a new voice.
Another unit elsewhere on the platform. They wouldn't make it in time. AMS Unit 4 spun a three-dimensional diagram of the platform in its CPU. Even at ideal travel speeds, it would take them 6 minutes to arrive at the boats.
Debris trajectory?
Unit 2 asked, tone level. Its fluids weren't raging. Its biology wasn't unbalanced or its files poorly installed.
Can we shift the...
Unit 4 had only been activated for a precious few minutes, and already it had only known two chemical modes. Panic.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.